should have thought of that today. So this is about a 20-minute section where I'm just going to talk about the typology. And whilst it's me here presenting, I do want to acknowledge Lindley Anderson, Gareth Trahan and Mally Brown, who are all from the University of Otago, and they were the co-authors and co-researchers with me on this work. It's a paper that's now published online, open access, so that means it's absolutely free. You don't need to belong to anything to access this one, so that you can download that. It's got the full details of what I'm going to be talking about. Okay. So, as I said, this research was specifically focused on clinician researchers doing research in health settings where the participants were also users of that service or were the focus of the service where the research was taking place. And we realise that there are lots of other ones that we've heard about, you know, the educator researching with students or the peer researching with peers. So I want you to extrapolate in your mind a bit as we go on, but this was particularly focused on clinician researchers. So we've heard about some what I would consider everyday examples of dual role already, which is fantastic. Probably the most common one that I experienced was while I was there as a researcher, I'd get asked a question, something clinical. I think this blue pill is the one that's called, or this is the one I'm supposed to take for, or, you know, if my blood pressure's over this, that's not so good, is it? Those types of questions. And of course, with my clinical hat on, if you like, I might well have had the expertise to answer the question quite accurately. It was a very simple, straightforward question. Really, the person was just seeking confirmation or reassurance about something they already knew. And I could think that actually responding to that in an appropriate way would just reassure, would reduce anxiety, would confirm accurate information, and it was timely to do that. On the other hand, sometimes I was thinking, now, if I answer that, will that change the responses to some of the things they will tell me later? So is it okay for me to answer that question or not? Now, that's a commonplace example. This one's not so commonplace. So nothing like this has ever happened to me, but sometimes the things that happen to clinician researchers you could put in the quite sort of extreme end of sudden and immediate conflict. How do I act here as a clinician or as a researcher? And actually one of the things that's happened is as I've gone on in my research career and as I've supervised more and more clinician researchers, more and more examples of dual role have come up. And so that's what started us off on this in the first place, is to say, well, could we be better prepared as supervisors? Could I be better prepared as a researcher to actually anticipate what might cause these feelings of dual role? Could I then be thinking about how I could plan to avoid them or just have a better plan in place to manage them when they do happen? So most of you, I'm sure, be familiar with this idea of conducting a systematic review, and that's what we were doing. So we had the typical extensive database search, we had the typical screening of studies to meet eligibility criteria, and we had the typical sort of critical appraisal stages. We had more than 7,000 records from our search. We ended up with 36 included studies. As a result, and all those studies were published in English, so we did miss stuff that wasn't. It was all research that was reporting on research in health research in patient settings where care was being delivered, and it reported on how and in what circumstances the clinician researcher experienced dual role. So we weren't interested in people's theoretical opinions of why it came up or some of the, you know, scholarly writings on bioethics. We wanted actual examples of when this happened and why it was happening and what people were feeling. So just to let you know a little bit about these 36 studies that the typology comes from. So 28 of the studies were what we call first person accounts. So this was a clinician researcher who'd done some research and then was writing a paper, an autobiographical paper, about their experience and what happened for them and the concern that they had. Okay. And then there were 8 what we call primary investigations. So this was a researcher coming along and asking clinician researchers about their experience of dual role. Okay. So those first person accounts were mostly by nurse researchers. Most of them were reflecting on qualitative research, but interestingly, 2 of these were people reflecting on their role in randomised trials, bringing up exactly the sort of thing that Philip was talking about, Joe was talking about. And the 8 primary investigations, once again, they were mostly recruiting nurse researchers. They all used qualitative methods to actually ask people about their experience of being a clinician researcher, and our quality grading meant that we had 1 we thought was trustworthy, 3 that were reasonably so, and 4 we weren't quite so sure about. But actually, as the course of our analysis went on, we didn't actually feel that those quality ratings were having much impact actually on the development of the typology. So we had 2 overarching themes in this typology. And one of them is about the things that happen, or the catalysts that around this idea that you act as a clinical resource in the research setting, and you do that for the benefit of the patient participant, the carers, or perhaps professional colleagues. And there are 5 particular catalysts which I'll cover in a minute. And then the other overarching theme was connection, and this is about, is this a clinician-patient relationship or is this a researcher-participant relationship that's going on here? And I'll come back to that one more in a minute. So I talked about this one before. So this is the idea that you might get asked a question. Seems quite straightforward. You could easily answer it based on your expertise. You could provide information, you could provide reassurance, you can confirm the accuracy of someone's existing information. And if actually you feel uncomfortable with doing that, you probably know exactly where you could refer the person to actually to find that bit of information or whatever. And so usually this one doesn't really cause much angst. People realise it's a dual role experience, but usually they've thought about it in advance. They could imagine it happening and they've thought about where the boundaries are in terms of, will I answer that sort of question or will I refer them to? Sometimes, however, the questions come with what the clinician researcher perceives as an agenda. And there are 2 sources of it, 2 main sources of agenda, and one is the participant and the other is clinical colleagues. Okay. So in the case of the patient participant, this might be the clinician has the sense that they're being asked to agree with the patient participant's perspective on something. Or they're being asked to perhaps refer on or expedite treatment or get something extra. And as I said, the other group in particular who can have an agenda are clinical colleagues. So this is the sort of thing where a clinician has been one of your recruiters or is referring people to you knowing that you're running a study, and they refer somebody to you, and then they come across you and they say, by the way, if there's anything of concern about that, do just let me know. And you think, tricky, not sure if I can do that one. And so it's difficult when it's a collegial relationship, because if you say no, will they stop referring patients to your study? But you have to respect those boundaries of research confidentiality of information that's been delivered in a research context. Now, in fact, I know of a third example here based on Claire's research. Now, Claire interviewed couples. And I know that one of the things that can happen, and I don't remember, Claire, whether it happened for you, I'm sorry, is that sometimes if you interview couples, but actually you interview them separately, then what you could have is one partner asking if the other partner said. So there can be other agendas as well, depending on your research methodology. Claire very cleverly interviewed her partners together. Okay. Now this one came up, I think it was in Joe, certainly in Joe's example, the idea about, you know, can you help? And that neonatal intensive care example was a, do I intervene? Do I just physically get in there and do what I need to do? And it can be that you see something happening and you think, will I? And you might decide not to, but you can actually be left with this feeling of, should I? Should I have done something? So that's the one that and that's an extreme example. But what would you do, for example, if one of your participants, say you were visiting your participants at home, and one of your participants said, "Oh, look, I'm really struggling to move this thing on my own. Could you just give me a hand?" Do you say, "Yes, I can give you a hand with moving that," or actually, "No, I don't think I can"?
RDA's always short of volunteers when I'm there. They always would like me to.
Yes, exactly.
So I typically would wear my town clothes.
Yep.
And my job is on.
And it's and this one's really, really tricky. This principle underpins a lot of these issues, is the whole idea of reciprocity. The give and take. What's within the boundaries of okay give and take, and what's not? And I'm not saying there's an absolute clear line in every situation, and I'm not saying I know exactly when it's okay and when it's not okay. It's one of those cases for discussion. Might partly depend on the research design, it might partly depend on who the people are, might partly depend on how urgent the need is. There might be a number of things that are part of the discussion, but this idea of reciprocity is very important. And so it's a case of when's okay and when's not okay. So this one about research or therapy, we had a fabulous example of this actually, is the idea that researchers worry about their participants confusing the research with the therapy. Which is which? And that's particularly the case when the research looks like the therapy or looks like what usually happens. So if your participant comes in and is part of a clinical trial protocol, you're asking them a set of questions, and they're exactly like the set of questions they normally get asked at a clinic appointment, how does the person distinguish which setting they're in when they're answering those sorts of questions? And, you know, researchers know that research is not principally for the benefit of the people who take part. But nevertheless, they may worry that their participants are taking part in order to seek personal benefit. So it really is it's pretty tricky. And researchers particularly worry about whether participants think that their future care is going to be harmed if they do or don't say certain things, do certain things, agree or not to participate. And another thing that comes up in this research or therapy one is the whole idea of, particularly this appears to happen in qualitative research, but I suspect it happens in quantitative research too, is participants will sometimes debrief an experience. So it may, in the researcher's mind, be an opportunity for that person to work through something and make sense of it. Might seem slightly cathartic, maybe. But then they leave that encounter and they think, now, was that harmful for that person to talk about that stuff or not? Was it therapeutic for them or was it not therapeutic for them? Have I done any harm? So the sort of concern that researchers may have. We've definitely had this one. You're the expert, often clinically, in the field that you're researching in. And you can't switch off your clinical reasoning. You can't switch off your clinical eyes. You can't switch off that thinking that's going on about, I wonder if this is this, or I wonder if that's connected to that. You may come across, actually, it's not that the participant says, I have a need that is not being met. It's that you recognize it. You're there uninvited recognizing it. You see it because you're a clinician and you think, you know, I don't think this person's accessing all the benefits that they're entitled to. You know, I wonder if this person's got undiagnosed diabetes. That sort of thing. And so that's a sort of an incidental finding in research, and you've got to have some plan about what's going to happen if that comes up. And so this can be really troubling because you have to make a decision about whether you're going to take action or not based on your clinical expertise. There's another form of uninvited expert, and this is where, as a clinician, you actually make a decision on behalf of a potentially eligible patient, potentially. So you think, yeah, that person's eligible, but actually I don't think it's in their best interest to take part, so I won't even tell them about this study. Or you think, now that person might be really good for this study. I know they're 6 months over the age limit, but we know that age limit cutoff's a bit arbitrary anyway, so it probably doesn't matter. So I'll see if we can get them in. Okay, so it's that clinical expertise being used to make research-related decisions on behalf of, you know, a trial team or a patient. So now we have connection, and this is recognising that the primary relationship when it's research is researcher-participant, but the shared clinical ground creates another type of relationship, so the peer-to-peer relationship, the educator-student relationship, the clinician-patient type relationship. And the thing is that acting clinically upregulates this, doesn't it? The more you do clinical things, the more that confusion is likely. Yeah. So the first one of these, once again, is really straightforward, and I think, Johnny, you were referring quite a lot to this, and we heard it from some of the other experiences too. You share this clinical ground, whether it's an experience of the condition, whether it's the clinical setting in which care is received, and so it's pretty easy to make some assumptions. That the language is shared, for example, the name of a procedure is known, maybe you share, you know, if the person refers to a particular doctor or a particular clinician, they expect that you know who they're talking about. And the flip side of this, of course, is if you have to go into really, really lengthy explanations about everything, that is irritating and it's time consuming, often for the participant, let alone yourself, but they're thinking, why are you telling me? You know I know this stuff. Really hits home for many researchers is in particularly in the qualitative space when they come to analyse their data and they think, I think I assumed that and now I'm not so sure that that's what they meant. Okay, so often unfortunately this one's discovered a bit late to do anything much about it. We've definitely had this one come up, the idea of I'm not sure that I want to answer that question because are you going to tell ACC about it? Okay, so this idea that the researcher suspects the participant is holding something back, the sort of sense of distrust can then lead the researcher to really wonder about why did this participant take part in this research? Did they feel coerced to take part? Were they bothered if they said no, then I would treat them differently as a clinician? Or one of my clinical colleagues would treat them differently? So that sort of concern you might have on the part of the participant. As a researcher, you might also have a concern, of course, that suspicion and holding back is affecting the quality of your data.
Just do you know, I've had the opposite experience where people are more likely to tell me more.
Yes.
As a researcher.
Yes.
Go out my field.
Yes, go for it. Tell, say it.
No,
say
just,
it.
Yeah, I'd say tell me more when I'm in my research
yep.
role than when I'm in a clinical role.
Absolutely.
The same person.
Absolutely.
More open and more relaxed.
Yeah. So the flip side of suspicion and holding back is actually you do get to hear more, and you get to hear criticisms of services and those sorts of things. And actually one of the things that appears in the literature is people can be reassured by the fact that they hear criticisms of care or whatever. It's sort of like, this might mean I'm really hearing the genuine article, yeah? Not just what they think I want to hear. To move myself along, I'm taking too long. So, revelations. By revelations, we mean that a participant may reveal much more intimate or close in information than you were expecting, might not even be directly related to the research. And you feel this, oh my goodness, what am I going to do? I've given these assurances of research confidentiality, and now I think I have to act. Clinically, legally, ethically, I think I have to do something. So revelations can, at the extreme end, you know, leave people actually overturning conditions of research confidentiality to take action. The last one, we definitely had this one coming up. Someone talked about being too close, being insider. Somebody just say, use the words insider. Yes, it was Tracy who was using the words insider. You see a lot of debate in the literature about insider-outsider status. And there are two particular forms of over-identification that clinician researchers recognise. And one is that they can over-identify with their participants. It's almost like a form of transference in therapy. They can assume, they can put themselves in that participant's shoes, and what they're feeling is what the participant then feels. Okay, so there's that concern. But the other concern is around the clinical self. The over-identification with my usual ways of seeing, my usual knowledge, my usual judgments, what I know is normal practice. I think I know that, and so I don't see what I'm not trained or expecting to see. So that sense of becoming too close to the self, becoming too close to see, it's particularly something that ethnographers are concerned about, you know, when they're there observing. Am I seeing just what I expect to see, or am I, you know, am I open enough to really observe what's going on? So this over-identification with patient participants, and this is on the slide, so don't worry, you can get that quote, and then this over-identification of the clinical self. And often, again, a bit like the assumptions one, this is the one that comes up in the analytic phase, and you start to think, is that really what's going on? Or is that just what I think was going on? Okay. So just very quickly, the last one. This is manipulation. And this is intentionally engaging in behaviours that create or foster that participant's sense of a clinical trust relationship for the purposes of the research. And to be honest, what you see written about in people's accounts of dual role is more their worry about this than actual instances of it. They're very concerned about this and not letting this happen. But part of it goes back to this whole idea of reciprocity. What can you say about yourself? What sort of relationship are you trying to form with your participants so they feel comfortable, so you feel comfortable? What's okay in terms of the boundaries? But this stuff can be down to as simple as wearing a uniform in a research role. What message do you give if you're there in a clinical uniform but you're there for research purposes? Very tricky. So I think what I want to say about this is that essentially people talk about glasses, you know, I put the glasses on and off, or I put the hats on and off. You can't, you wear it. It's your skin, your clinical skin. You can't take it off It comes with you. It's part of your biography. Just like being a person with spinal cord injury is part of your biography. Just like being a clinical colleague is part of your biography. It's there. And so the issue here is not that that's right or wrong, but the thing is more about, is this actually inevitable? Is this unsurprising? It's not necessarily good or bad. It's not specific to qualitative or quantitative research. The question is, what do we do about it? We're going to stop researching. We need to be thinking clearly about the ethical and the methodological implications of this thing called dual role. And we need to do that for participant safety, and we need to do it for researcher safety. So what we're going to be talking about right now is, so what are we going to do? Okay. What's it? Yes, I am going to make you do it. You're dead, right? You know I'm getting you to do this, don't you? It's because actually I don't know all the answers and I hope you're going to give me some. So what I'd really like you to do in your small groups is to choose a catalyst from the typology or one from your own experience. Brainstorm some ideas about maybe reducing the likelihood of it happening at all. Maybe you think it's going to happen, it's almost inevitable, so what might you do to manage it if that's the case? If you choose something that you sort of think this is the sort of thing that could come up unexpectedly, have a think about, well, if it came up all of a sudden, you know, how could I have prepared? Are there any ways I could have prepared for it? What decision rules might I use? And think too about how you can remain alert to the possibility of this thing happening. We'd like you to write one management strategy per post-it note, and part of that is because we think management strategies are likely to cross different sorts of catalysts. It's not that there'll be a single management strategy that's applied only for this thing. It's likely to be some of the things you talk about apply in multiple ways. And if you can work quite quickly, it would be really neat if you addressed three different things and came up with maybe three or four different management strategies, and we'll collect them all together at the end and have a bit of a discussion about them.